JTodd, talk to me.
How was Lake Douglas? How did it treat you?
It was hard. It was tough. It was like no bites. No bites the first day. 5 bites the second day. But they were almost 18 pounds.
You had 5 of the right bites.
5 of the right bites. Throwing the right bait.
Yes. Is it a bait or is it a rig?
It's a rig.
That's a
mess.
It's a mess. It's a big mess. It's a fun mess.
It is a fun mess. You know, we don't get a chance to throw it in the leads. And I purposely have not thrown it because of that. But to actually get a chance to get on the Tennessee River this time of year and focus on suspended fish, it kind of reminded me of swim bait fishing.
Yeah.
You know, at home.
That's what you told me. You said, just throw it like throwing a swim bait.
Yeah, and that...
That helped me, confidence. I've done real well with it in Oklahoma. I've caught a lot of fish on the schooling rigs when I throw, by Picasso, but when you leave your home lakes and you come to a foreign lake that you've never caught fish on it doing, there's always that challenge because there's so many other ways to catch fish that it's not a rig that you're going to go out and just set the world on fire. You will over time, but it's not something you can just get bit on. I never got bit in practice.
You have to have a lot of confidence in it, just like you do swim bait fishing.
Swim bait's the exact same thing.
I mean, it's really no different. But you have, you know, when it's just like if you were fishing for 5 bites, you know, you're going to catch 14, maybe 15 pounds with 5 jerkbait bites, for instance.
Right.
With this rig, you're fishing for, if you catch 3 of them, they're going to weigh 12 pounds. If you catch 4, they're going to weigh 16. If you catch 5, they're going to weigh 20, minimum.
Right.
That's a minimum.
You're absolutely right.
So why not catch 3 that's going to weigh 12? You know, I mean, why not?
Perfect example.
You're not
going
to be able to compete if you don't do
it. Me, the first thing. Well, I never got bit in practice. I never got bit in practice.
Well, I told my partner today. I told him, and he's practicing for the open. I was lucky enough to find this guy, you know, that had a boat, you know, because my engine blew up. But
yeah, tell us about that real quick.
Yeah, I mean, you know, I blew up my engine at 6:30 this morning.
We're staying down at the bottom of the lake.
I didn't even make it to takeoff.
I'm running down the lake in the morning. I'm like, woo, going 74. Am I trying? And I look back, and I'm like,
where's JTodd?
Where is JTodd? And I stop, and I wait, and I mean, something's wrong. He's not behind me. You got a really fast boat, dude. So I turn around, and I run back, and I saw you standing on the trolling motor. I'm like, oh no!
It popped. I mean, popped it did. Motor. You know, and luckily it did it within a mile. But you know, when you came back and pulled me in, it saved a lot of time for me because I was able to load the boat up and then go and figure out what the problem was. And once I knew the problem couldn't be fixed, I immediately went to launch, and I was going to launch and just fish in my trolling motor.
Just real quick, just so you know, I made it there, blasted off with everybody else. No,
yeah,
wasn't late, so there was no worries. But the only thing I can't complain about,
that was
ever put your hands in the water with your gloves on when it is freezing out. Because that entire run, when it was a 10-minute
like,
run to blast off, my hands went numb.
It was 30 degrees this morning. And actually, when I loaded, it was 30 degrees when we put in. But when I loaded the boat up and went headed to Bass Pro to get worked on, it was actually 29.
Yeah. Well,
and I was
like,
you know, I thought about your hands. Like, dude, he's already got hands. His gloves are already wet. His hands are already wet.
I my hands out there. Dude, it was like this. I was so cold this morning. I just cast it.
I snorted. I didn't mean to snort. I'm trying not to.
Even at the end of the day, everyone's like, hold your fish up. My hands are like frozen stuff.
Yeah,
I was like,
some brutal.
I got some real good bass hands here. I mean, there's still a little bit of blood on and everything else, but.
But you know, that's part of helping each other out. That's why.
That's what we do.
What do you call it today, you know?
We're good friends, and we'd never leave either one of us stranded out there, you know. The day's a long day out there. We'll make it work. But, I didn't even get a bite till 10, but I'll tell you what I did is I listened to what you told me yesterday. You said fishing like a swim bait. You know, you mentioned that wind was going to be a big factor. And I just started running gun.
You know, you're talking about the wind, and I do, like, when you're talking about suspended fish.
Yeah.
They're on the shad.
Yeah.
And the only way that you can really target suspended fish is if that wind blows those shad to a certain point or side of a point. It creates an ambush spot for that bass or school of bass.
The wind, what it does,
but you can target that.
It seems like it really creates a current, and the current is what moves those bait fish up there. Mm-hmm. Yeah, because that's what I started keying it. Certain areas where, like you said, there would be ambush points for the fish, but you can't physically see them from above. You might notice it on your graph a break or something like that.
Yeah, but out there
you can also see. Yeah,
out there swimming around off of that point, you can't put that bait in their face, but with them actually on or close to a structure like a point, you can target a certain, you know, you can target one or maybe two, you know, but all we need is five.
Right.
So that's where, like, fishing for suspended fish, I think, is crucial that you recognize that fact that there's a lot of them out there, but the only ones you're going to catch are the ones that you can target. The ones that you can target are absolutely impossible to catch.
Right.
Even with an Alabama rig.
Yeah, because they could be Tennessee over 100 feet of water. I mean, they could be...
You know why I think they made it a Tennessee rig instead of Alabama rig?
Why is
that? Because they were jealous.
They were jealous.
Tennessee was jealous.
They needed a rig.
They needed a rig.
Oklahoma needs a rig. We got the Biffle head, though.
That's true. That's, yeah.
What else do you need? But California, what's that? California, swim bait. Just straight up.
That's straight up swim bait.
Swim bait, yeah. I need swim bait rig. What about Georgia? Is there a PG rig?
We haven't come out with that yet. We're waiting.
You need a JTizzle. JTodd's new nickname is JTizzle, by the way. Everybody, let's get it straight. JTizzle. All
right.
When this dude gets hot and he gets on a roll, there's no stopping. JTizzle time.
That's right. We'll see what happens. We're having a lot of fun, though. We've had a lot of fun this week, and we had a lot of fun at Falcon. You know, we're learning, you know, I think the key things that we're learning is just to be positive and not worry too much about what happens.
You're absolutely right. It's funny you say that because I was at a fuel tank at a gas stop, you know, and I was pumping the foam boat up one morning and it spilled in my hand or something. I'm like, man, I got gas in my hand, you know. Fish don't like the smell of gas, you know, whatever. Bobby Lane looks at me and goes, boom, boom. An angry man catches no fish. I busted up laughing, and I thought about it. It's probably the best one-liner,
yeah,
I've ever heard, because it's so true.
And you know, he has another term, Bobby Lane does.
Oh, does he?
It is what it is.
It is what it is?
It is what it is. Get gas on your hands, I'll suck it in. It is what it is.
Yeah, and that's probably why he does so good. He's just relaxed, deals with it. No big deal.
I think we'll approach all these tournaments with that in mind and that mentality. I think we'll do better.
Yes.
As an angler, as a competitor, and I think a lot of you, you know, the guys that beat us all the time, your KBDs or, you know, Mark Rose, great competitor.
Mm-hmm.
We have a lot of those guys that are consistently better than we are all the time.
Right.
And by competing with those people is what makes us better.
Absolutely.
So you're only as good as your competition. Mm-hmm. And I really feel like the only way to get better is to have those people above you that are more competitive and then make you more competitive. That's the key to being
on your toes.
That's the key to being better, is put yourself in a position like we do with the elites or the PAAs or FLWs. If you put yourself in that position, you're going to make yourself be a better fisherman.
Dude, you're absolutely right. I mean, back when I used to snowboard all the time, you know, you go with buddies that are just riding down the slopes, you know, and just hit a little berm or whatever. Then you go with your buddies and you're like, dude, let's go do some backflips and this and that. And you want to, you know, you try to hang with them. And then next thing you know, you're doing big airs and grabs.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, that's the same with fishing, same with any other sport. You only get better when you hang with people that are better than you.
Right.
Or are constantly competing against you. And that's what, it's one of the reasons I'm fishing all three tours this year. I mean...
Well, that's one of the reasons I came to the PAA from Lake Falcons, because I almost forced myself not to practice. And that's something I talked to my wife about, I talked to Mike Armour about. And I talked to my dad about that. I said, you know, I'm a little disappointed in my performance the first day at Falcon because I stayed on one place too long. The second day, I actually was forced to go practice, and I did well. So, you know, my thinking is, hey, come up here. It's the third week, you know, of fishing. But to do it without any practice is something that I haven't forced myself to do. And I think if we'll force ourselves to do that more often, it might make us a better competitor. Not necessarily a better fisherman as far as just going out for fun, but as far as competing in a tournament. Because when you compete against these guys, one of the things I've realized is when you find fish, you don't always find them by yourself. There's always somebody else that finds them.
Right.
So, therefore, you have to put yourself in that position more often to be able to collectively think, how am I going to compete against this field with these adversities? And that right there will set you apart and make you more competitive than a snail, if that makes sense.
No, I think that's an awesome way of looking at it. I totally agree. I mean, one of the reasons I came here was a little different. I came off a horrible tournament Falcon that was probably one of the worst fishing performances of my life after having a pretty solid start to a season.
Right.
And I know I had the bites, the opportunities, whatever. Everyone says that. I just failed. The fish beat me. They whooped my bass. You know what I'm saying? Anyway, I got an FLW tournament in 2 weeks. And whenever you go into another event, what's on your mind? It's the last event you had.
Yeah.
So if you go into another event thinking, gosh, I stunk it up, you know, because this is a very humbling sport. I mean, the highs are like the greatest things in the world. You're just like, man, I'm invincible. I can catch bass anywhere I go. Then all of a sudden, you go to the best fishery and you bomb. And everybody else catches them. And they look at you like, well, what are you doing here? At least that's how I felt.
Yeah.
Exactly. Wayne in right behind Van Damme. He's got 28 pounds,
yeah.
And I got.
I know. I took the walk of shame.
I took
the walk of shame.
You got to weigh in, though. I mean, as much as you don't want to weigh in, guys, you got to.
5 pounds, 11 ounces, my first day at Falcon is like, you know, you just don't want to do that.
I might have gotten 2 points more, or, you know, saved 2 points by weighing in that day.
Yeah.
Those
2 points. 2 points you needed to make
at the end of the season?
Right.
It's going to be something.
Yeah, there's never a walk of shame. I mean, when you're, and I say that jokingly, a walk of shame, but when you're in an elite group, you know, you never should feel that way.
It's true.
Honestly, it's hard not to.
I know, especially when you hear a guy's daughter goes out and catches 10 pounders. And,
and, you know.
And Jordan.
Amar's like.
His daughter, That was.
He's the weirdest dude out there, but he's so cool because his kids out there catching dogs out there.
Unbelievable.
It's great.
But anyway, what I was
getting at. Tom Lundgren even caught 11.
I know, Tom. You're a stud. He's our publicist. He's the man. But here's what I was getting at. Is that I didn't want to go into the FLW at Beaver Lake. That's a lake I've never really done good at. With the history of what I did at Falcon, because I know that my practice is going to be a challenge. I'm not going to go there and just set the world on fire. I'm not going to go get bit right away. I'm not going to get the right bites right away. It might take me my entire practice to come across something small, something that might work for me. And hopefully it's something that'll lead into a good tournament. But if my mind is off the last tournament we fish, you know, this happens at every tournament, everybody. You think about the last one. You pull your rods out of your rod locker. Last tournament you fished was, you know, you just think about everything you do. Retie and reset and respawn, all you're thinking about was the last event. I mean, it's true. And then you're trying to forward it to the next event.
This is
Here, and then when I had the first day at 7 pounds, I was like, this isn't why I came here. I didn't come here to bomb.
Right.
So I after talking with you and you clued me in on throwing the rig, you know, I knew that was my only chance of making a comeback, only way to make a strong performance. Fortunately, it worked out for me. I got 22 pounds a day. But,
and the biggest comeback of the whole tournament.
It was the biggest comeback.
Yep.
I appreciate it.
Biggest deal.
And got me in the money. Actually went from 62nd to 22nd.
So 3,000 on a comeback.
Yeah. You know, I'll take it. But what it does for me confidence-wise, that's what's dangerous. That's what's going to – if this did not happen today, if things went the other way and I didn't catch them, it may turn my course from a positive to a slight negative to a real negative. Now we had a slight negative, speed bump.
Turned it into a positive.
Back down that driveway, twisty, windy one, yeah. And went up the right road, kind of like I did here at the cabin. But
yeah, be careful when you go to Sevierville. Taking a road less traveled. There might be a gate at the end of the day. You have to back up for 2 miles.
We had fun. Anyway, I just want to wish everyone a happy Easter. It's a big weekend this weekend, and everyone be safe in your travels, and spend lots of time with your family and kids.
Absolutely. It's great, bro.
Appreciate it, bro.